a solution to our putative quantum gravity dynamical equations. And well, our expectations are clearly that on very short length scales, certainly around the Planck scale, things will be, quantum fluctuations will be large. And well, whatever that entails for the geometry, then the question one might ask is how much is then left over of our classical notions of, I mean, how we understand curvature and space-time geometry on those scales. I mean, and what maybe what can we expect to be, what kind of remnants can we still expect to be meaningful on that scale? But of course, one can think of all kinds of scenarios where nothing is left over. And of course, at least one with the question, well, what is that? What is there then? Now, this seems to open the door to just wild speculation at the Planck scale. But thank goodness, there's still something like, you know, the classical limit. So whatever you postulate to govern dynamics at the Planck scale, you have to show that in a sufficiently large scale limit, somehow recovers the structures of classical general relativity. We had also seen that the evaluation of such a non-perturbative path integral will, in general, require sophisticated computational and numerical tools, because, of course, we are going far beyond evaluating Gaussian integrals. I mean, these are, you know, they're exactly not of the perturbative form. So one has to really think long and hard about how to tackle them. Monte Carlo simulations I had very briefly talked about are just one time-honored way of trying to do this and trying to compute path integrals and observables associated with them. We had then seen how this can play out in a very concrete construction where we used an ensemble of kind of triangulated piecewise flat geometries to represent a non-perturbative path integral at a regularized level. And then I told you, well, what one then tries to do, one does it for a fixed size lattice, or at least a lattice with some maximum size in terms of building blocks, and then one tries to systematically study how one's observables behave in a limit where you let the lattice become bigger and bigger. And I gave you a nice, a very kind of very simple-minded and beautifully geometric example of an observable where through measurements of volumes, kind of concentric geodesic balls, you could learn something about what I call the Hausdorff dimension of the space. So that is just some a measurement where you relate volumes of balls to their radius. And it's very nice because it's applicable rather generally. I mean, as long as you can still kind of have a meaning to what a volume is, and that often you have, you know, you can just count building blocks. That is a kind of very natural notion of a volume. And you have still some notion of a distance, a geodesic distance in this case, then you can just make this measurement. And it allowed us to extract a Hausdorff dimension of now a particular class of models. And somewhat surprisingly, the finding was that this dimension, you know, in some n going to infinity limit, didn't recover at all the expected number, which would be 4, because 4-dimensional building blocks was the thing you started with. So there are various lessons to be learned from this. So let me just write them down explicitly, because as I claim, they are rather generic. So they're not very particular, you know, to this one approach. So firstly, if you work in this kind of non-perturbative approach, dimension, various notions of dimension one might have, becomes a dynamical notion And I mean here in the sense that there is, it just does not have to coincide with what you feed in at the outset, you know, in terms of the dimensionality of your building blocks. And as I said, well, the reason for this is, of course, you're taking non-trivial limits, infinite limits, obviously. And ultimately, well, what is responsible is the fact that if you are in a certain region of phase space, right, by phase space, I just mean, you know, the bare couplings that you're putting into the weights of your bus integrals, they have a, well, have a certain weight, then the system is driven to a particular class of configurations. And this class of configurations, well, in the cases we looked at yesterday, has absolutely nothing to do with extended geometries. But in the one case, we found these kind of crumpled configurations where, which have just a tiny diameter and lots of volume stuffed in. And on the other hand, we found another extreme where the system is driven to preferentially form these kind of branched polymeric structures. And of course, when you look, you know, at these polymers, if you go closer, of course, if you go then back to the cutoff scale, of course, you'll see that there are your four-dimensional building blocks are still there. But that's not the point. I mean, you're interested in the structure on scales that is, you know, at least kind of a magnitude larger than the scale of the individual building blocks. Because that just tells you something about the bias you're putting in by your rather arbitrary regularization construction. So, so you see, the difficulty then appears to be, or at least one of the difficulties, is to generate something that's four-dimensional and has a nice kind of classical limit. So it's non-trivial. To dynamically generate an extended four-dimensional quantum geometry. And of course, it has to do also with the non-perturbative nature that you really allow that your spacetimes or the kind of the virtual space times the summing over in the path integral on very short scales can be highly quantum fluctuating, can be very, very far away from classicality. And then you can run into these degeneracies. But there's nothing, of course, you know, if by hand you suppress these fluctuations, then of course you can just force yourself back to some situation where you're sitting very close to, say, Minkowski space. But that's not the point. Of course, what you want to show is there is a non-trivial quantum dynamics, and the fluctuations are allowed to be large on the Planck scale, the natural scale we associated with these. But nevertheless, they conspire in a quantum superposition to something that is meaningful on very large scales and has a nice classical limit. So, well, in the best of all worlds, that's what we want to find. So, you know, I subsumed this type of non-perturbative surprise by saying, well, it's really due, you can think of it as being due to entropy. By entropy, I mean number of microstates that realize, you know, a given value of the weight or the action weight, e to the IS or e to the minus s of some Euclidean weight. And if you're in a perturbative situation, see, you could think of it, if you wanted to translate it to a continuum language, as the measure. But so why don't you see that semi-classically, the measure? Because, well, the measure doesn't have any tunable constants associated with it. Whereas, you know, if you have e to the is or e to the minus s Euclidean, there are tunable parameters in there. And if you think of, you know, putting your h bar in there, you have, of course, s divided by h bar. And for sufficiently small h bar, the contributions from the action will always dominate. So in what you call a classical limit over anything that comes from the measure. So that's why these are contributions you don't see in this way, semi-classically. So for this, then, you do need to be able to evaluate these sums of integrals non-perturbatively. OK, well, here's a suggested cure. As I said, this is very generic. What you find for these dynamically triangulated models. But to cut a long story short, because I have only about 45 minutes left in the course, you put an additional structure on this dynamical triangulation. So the results where this funny Hausdorff dimension came out, they referred to these isotropic configurations, these Euclidean configurations, where I hadn't distinguished any time direction, I hadn't distinguished, there was no causal structure anywhere in the geometries. So the claim is, if you reintroduce this in a specific way, you're curing this problem here. This will still be true to an extent, and you will still find that on very small scales, dimensions are not what you expect them to be. But on large scales, they approach asymptotically 4. So that's something interesting to say. So these are causal dynamical triangulations, and CDT abbreviated, so something I've worked on for quite some years. If you want to look at a recent set of lecture notes, you can go to the archives, 1007-2560. Of course, I will be only able to sketch this very briefly today. So the issue, I have these totally Euclidean structures. How do I reintroduce some causality back there? Well, one step is kind of very simple. I've already mentioned this. You don't use Euclidean building blocks, but you use Minkowskian building blocks. So you cut them out, not from flat Euclidean space, but you think of them as being cut out from a Minkowskian flat space. And the distinction is, of course, well, the geometric properties are different. And I do have light cones in there. Secondly, this is what it turns out. Well, one has to do. One doesn't have too much choice, actually, in doing this. One introduces a notion of time, and more specifically, its proper time. And forbids certain acausal configurations to appear. And these are known affectionately as baby universes. So let me just make a drawing. Let's keep things very simple. Let's see what it entails in two dimensions. So just to illustrate, so let me, time goes this way up in my drawings. Now, what's a typical contribution to the path integral in this causal formulation? So a CDT history, I could call it. These geometries are like what you require in the classical theory. They are a Cartesian product of a time axis and some spatial manifold of some topology. We are in two dimensions. Let's be very simple-minded and choose the spatial topology just to be a compact S1. So my spatial universe is just a circle. And the only geometric a characteristic it has is a length. So all it can do is kind of fluctuate as a function of time. That length can fluctuate. So it's like a quantum mechanical model in some way. So this is always what one of these CDT histories looks like. It's a two-dimensional triangulation, but you've cut it up into kind of spatial, discrete spatial slices. So this is, you know, some proper time. And then you have adjacent slices, which are of different lengths in general. And they are triangulated in some way. So it's like, you know, strips of triangles, up and down triangles, between each step, you know, t and t plus delta t, where these come in units of one. So here's a piece of triangulation for you. And the idea is then you have here some out geometry, some other boundary of a certain length. So this is what the discretized geometries look like in this causal approach. Now, how can I compare them to, how can I understand what is the essential difference of this to Euclidean geometry? I can also say, OK, I just look at Euclidean geometries that are, that live on, you know, an S1 cross R or S1 cross an interval. But they don't come with any natural notion of time. But what I can always do is I can just by force superimpose a notion of time on them. For example, so that's just what, so this picture will be. So I have just here some, you know, wild Euclidean geometry. You know, it's, well, it's a cylinder. It has cylinder topology. So what I do is I say I start from this boundary. And then I just look at all points that are a distance one away. So a geodesic step one. This is just Euclidean with respect to the kind of the Euclidean metric that comes with the triangles. And then I get some slicing, you see. And I then look, you know, what is one more step away, a distance two away from my initial surface. I can clearly kind of slice this just by brute force, say starting from a non-trivial boundary. So what's now the difference between those guys and those guys? So these are also triangulated in some way. The difference here is that when I do this for a generic Euclidean geometry, it's not true that this will be a of the form of an interval cross S1. Because typically, as I run through this, you see, I will find at a given time step, well, things can split up, and they can end here. You see, when if I cut it somewhere here, at some time step, I find not a single S1, but three. So there's one here, there's one here, and there's one here. So at this generically, they're all over. If you know, you take a general Euclidean triangulation and you force such a time slicing upon it, then you will just find that this happens generically. So at any given time, the topology will change as a function of time, generally speaking. So this is a general dynamically triangulated history. So a Euclidean object, an inherently Euclidean object. And the point is here that the spatial topology will change as a function of time. As a function of time. Now, of course, these are not real geometries. I mean, they are virtual path integral histories. So there is absolutely nothing wrong with these histories in the first place, because we don't know what, you know, generalized kind of configurations we should be summing over in the path integral to contribute to the quantum amplitude. No one tells us. Now, the point is to say, can I just do either of these things, you know, do the computations, see what I get, and compare whether I get equivalent or identical outcomes? And the answer is, well, you can do the calculations. And as I already mentioned yesterday, the outcomes are different and really inequivalent in terms of their physical properties, their scaling properties. So these are two inequivalent models. And this is, well, as far as I know, kind of the first very just explicit toy model of quantum geometry where this was explicitly shown. So in d equal to 2, c dt and dt path integrals lead to inequivalent continuum quantum theories. So it's a nice conclusion. It says, well, signature matters, right? And look, here's an explicit example. So the kind of things you can compute here are things like propagators. You know, you have a time, you can compute loop to loop. I mean, a loop is just your universe, loop to loop correlators and things like this. And you can explicitly compare them. Now, let us look a little bit in detail at this here. So when I'm saying I can solve this model, what I do is I start with a history. I start with a Lorentzian signature path integral, which has, you know, weights e to the is. I then use a Wick rotation that exists for these objects. I Wick rotate them. Then I get a real kind of Euclidean looking partition function. I do the computation. I'm able to compute in the asymptotic limit what it is for suitable choices of the coupling. That's just a single coupling, lambda, the cosmological constant. And then I get, for example, a propagator. And in this propagator, there is a time variable. And this I analytically Wick rotate back. And then I have a nice Lorentzian type Green's function. And it's a very reasonable quantity. It has all the properties one would expect from that. So that's the general strategy you will choose in these models in general. 2D is special and very nice because things you can do things totally explicitly and, you know, analytically, at least. I mean, for the leading terms in an asymptotic limit. Now, in two dimensions, how does this Wick rotation work? Because as I already mentioned, I mean, there's always this problem if you really insist on starting from a Lorentzian signature path integral, and it's not a perturbative path integral where you can just appeal to Minkowski background structure and appeal to, you know, Osterwalder-Schrader axioms. Well, what on earth, what is the Wick rotation in the first place? Now, it turns out that these objects, they have a nice Wick rotation in the sense that there is a unique map of any one of these piecewise flat Lorentzian structures to one, to a well-defined Euclidean structure. So this works in the following way. Here I have my Minkowskian in two dimensions, my Minkowskian little triangular building blocks. This and the upside down version of this. You know, I stick them together. So like I did here, gluing, you know, upside triangles and upside down triangles in these strips. And everything is given to me by the edge length of these three edges that make up the triangle. And I choose two of them to be time-like and one of them to be space-like, indicated. So I have now kind of two lattice spacings, right? The things I want to shrink to zero in the end. One is for all the space-like links, and the other one is for all the time-like links. Now, what I then choose is I choose a t squared to be proportional with a new proportionality coefficient I call alpha to a s squared. And of course, now, if I'm in Lorentzian, yes, I choose these time-likes, then these squares are, of course, negative. I t squared is some negative number. So in this equation, alpha is now is some positive number. And I call this the anisotropy parameter. So I choose this to be the case. Now, of course, what happens if I now compute any quantities like the action? Of course, it depends on the edge length. And using this relation, it will depend also on alpha. Now, what my Wick rotation will be, it will be a rotation of this parameter alpha in the complex lower half alpha plane. And you can already, you know, understand what the rationale behind it is. If I rotate this to negative values, then I get a relation at squared equals something, you know, positive times as squared, which just means that at squared will then be space-like also after that rotation. Of course, you still have a relative scaling then. I mean, well, you know, how long is it? It needn't be 1 or minus 1, but it could be anything. Well, not anything, but it could vary over quite some range. So what the Wick rotation is in this framework is a map alpha to minus alpha in the, as I said, the lower half plane alpha, the complex alpha plane. And the very nice thing is that, so it's clear that in this way, I map a Lorentzian geometry onto Euclidean geometry with, in a unique way, with certain edge lengths for the Euclidean geometry. And of course, you see, the Euclidean geometry, although it's now, well, it's purely Euclidean, but it retains some memory, you could say, of what I initially required here, namely the absence of such branchings. So these, you know, this is a baby universe, a thing that branches out here. These are baby universes, and by construction, they were absent here. Therefore, see that the point is, if I now look at what are the domains of my respective path integrals, if I Wick rotate, so my Lorentzian dynamical triangulations or my causal dynamical triangulations, so understand it as a map, you know, Wick of these objects, it's a strict subspace of all Euclidean dynamical triangulations. Because I got rid of all these, of course, of all these branching things. And it turns out, well, that this space has even, you know, if I look at this, the space that's spanned by these guys here, it's a subspace essentially of measure zero in the space of all those. And it just means, well, it has the chance of being a totally different path integral. And that explains also why I can get two totally inequivalent results from it. So this construction and this Wick rotation works, as you can easily see, in all dimensions. So in higher dimensions, you again, you kind of, you stack your geometries as a sequence of layers. In three dimensions, you know, these layers would then consist of tetrahedra, which have time-like links which you can Wick rotate in exactly this manner, and spatial links, and the same in higher dimensions. So you have this unique mapping, Lorentzian objects to Euclidean ones. And the nice thing is that also exactly under this mapping, what was your e to the is of your original geometry T, the Lorentzian one, is mapped onto e to the minus s Euclidean of your kind of Wick rotated T So exactly as, you know, one would like. Okay, now, let me just briefly sketch. Of course, this is a two-dimensional toy example, but just to explain to you some of the underlying ideas and strategies. And let's just briefly have a look at what happens when you now implement this as a quantization, fast integral quantization program in four dimensions. Okay. So these are my causally triangulated models. Now, it turns out I have, in the Lorentzian domain, I have two types of building blocks. And they're a bit tricky to draw, but that, you know, fill with which you fill out these sandwiches between some proper time tau and proper time tau plus 1. So one is a building block that we call 4-1, because it shares four vertices with the lower layer and just a single one with the upper layer. And it's of the form down here in the spatial, lower spatial layer. It has the form of a tetrahedron. And then I connect each of the edges of the spatial tetrahedron via time-like edges with the next slice. There's another building block which you need in order to be able, together with this one and its time inverse, these slices. And these are the, they're called the 3-2 building blocks. So here, in the lower plane, not plane, but space, they share a triangle with it. In the upper one, there is a single link. And now you get a fourth simplex by connecting up, you know, each of these vertices which each, with each of the lower ones in this manner. Then that is a fourth simplex, right? It has then it has five corners. It has, you know, 10 edges. Oh, well, you work out the geometry here. And these again have all spatial lengths of the cutoff, A. I can drop the A if I like. And here these are time-like links, minus alpha A squared, all the ones that extrapolate between adjacent slices. And what you then do, you just take the Ratchet action. You just evaluate what it is on geometries, which I construct from these building blocks. And the action actually then assumes a very simple form. It just depends on variables that essentially count different types of building blocks, simplices, and subsimplices. I'm not going to write it down because I don't have time for doing this. But what I'll do is I draw the phase diagram of this theory. And the phase diagram, an example we met already yesterday, was to say, okay, now, how many free parameters do appear now in the action weights of my model? And how does the outcome depend on where I am in the coupling constant space or the phase space of this model? Now, what turns out again, that you need, so you have three parameters again. You have G Newton, but we use this kappa instead, which was proportional to 1 over G Newton. We have a cosmological constant. And we also now keep explicitly track of this alpha, this anisotropy parameter. And what turns out, just like what you had to do in this three-dimensional Euclidean model I talked about yesterday, you have to fine-tune this to its critical surface in order to be in a situation where a large n limit exists at all. So it's the same story. You go basically your path integral diverges as a function of n, the number of top dimensional simplices, exponentially. And then you fine tune your lambda in the volume term of the action exactly that it, you know, just about compensates for this leading divergence. Yes?
So the way you tune this lambda, is this somehow, well, we've got similar values for the lambda as observed.
Oh, okay. Yes. No, it's slightly different. So this is, when I'm talking about these are the bare coupling constants. So they don't have an immediate physical value. So the physical coupling constants associated with those are determined by how you approach, in this case, the critical surface. And the rate of approach introduces, I mean, roughly speaking, it goes like this. So you have to tune this to some lambda critical. So these are the bare objects. And this is proportional. This becomes some a squared. I think of that now as a dimension, a full length scale, times some lambda renormalized. And this will be the parameter that's left over in the associated continuum theory. It will be dimension full, in this case, you know, one over length squared. And it's a free parameter of the resulting theory. The only thing that this construction does, because remember from yesterday, I'm forced to approach lambda critical from one direction, namely from the direction where the partition function exists and is finite. It forces lambda renormalized to be non-negative. So it can be, it's a free parameter, but it has to be positive. So we are fine if the world is, you know, a de Sitter space. If the world turns out to be an anti-de Sitter space, you know, we may have a problem. But right now, things look OK. OK, so here's our phase diagram. So the phase diagram now consists of the remaining two parameters. I have already, you know, tuned myself to the lambda critical surface, which is two-dimensional in this three-dimensional coupling constant space. And on this, I now have a dependence on the kappa and the alpha. Actually, we use a slightly algebraically redefined version of this alpha, which we call capital delta. But let me not go into the details of this. The main point is that, roughly speaking, we find a phase diagram that consists of three phases. This is kappa, and this is delta. And delta depends on this alpha, as I said. With phase transition lines in between them. So we call these A, B, and C. And of course, what you would now do, you would look at phase A and phase B and phase C, and just look, well, what kind of quantum geometries? I mean, what is the superposition? What does it give me in these regions? And is there anything where I can anything that reminds me, say, on large scales, of a classical geometry? And the answer is, beautifully, there appears to be just one phase where apparently geometry is extended and, in a limit of large scales, appears to be four-dimensional. Four-dimensional within the error bars of my numerical simulations. Okay. So this is phase, the nice phase. So here, extended geometry is found. And I explained this in a second, what I mean by this. This phase A and phase B, of course, one has looked at them more closely, and also, you know, what characterizes their geometry. You can think of them as kind of Lorentzian versions of these degenerate phases that appear, as I told you, generically in the Euclidean models. So this is some kind of Lorentzian version of the branch polymer phase. Of course, it looks slightly different because, you know, baby universes in the time direction are suppressed and absent. But if you look in the spatial directions, there's still many of them, right? So they can also proliferate depending on where you sit with your coupling constants. You can be driven to a region where these totally dominate, and then the overall geometry, again, totally degenerates. This is some kind of remnant of the crumpled phase. So things like to condense on few vertices. But it has now opened up a new phase. And of course, when we understood this, of course, this was kind of the, well, of central interest. Now, what is this? Is this anything reasonable? Is this anything that might have a good classical limit, but at the same time, of course, interesting quantum properties? And, well, the way we determine this, or at least, you know, to zeros and first order, is again by kind of running experiments on these. Yes? Yeah. Yes.
How this is corresponding to, like,
okay.
This
yes.
means that
yes. Delta equal to zero corresponds to alpha being one, if you like.
Okay.
So there you would say, at least in this discretized picture, you choose all the edge lengths equal. So you're in an equilateral case. I mean, what deeper significance this has after you, when you look at the renormalized theory, is a priori not clear. I mean, one really is talking here about bare parameters. So one has to always be rather careful and not to jump to conclusions what it means for renormalized quantities. So the nice thing is, so it's you know, our version of doing experimental gravity. In what sense? So, you know, you have this superposition. Some of what the Monte Carlo simulations create for you, you know, it's this random path in the path of all configurations. And you want to understand now, you know, what are the properties of the superposition or of the typical path in a way. So you have, again, you have to ask the right question. So you're forced, and you are in a situation where, apart from a time parameter, you don't have any coordinates. So you have to formulate observables and look how they behave. And from those kind of totally coordinate invariant quantities, you have to make your deductions of what is the geometry of that space. There are various interesting things one can look at. So, but let me first kind of summarize kind of what our findings are. So there's concrete evidence for basically the expected structures we wanted to find. So firstly, one finds a classical, essentially kind of classical indication of classical behavior on large scales. And in particular, there seems to be some stable ground state, which on large scales appears to be four-dimensional. So let me call this a quantum geometry coming out of this path integral construction. And its shape, so I explain in a second what this is. So well, I should write it here, its shape. So it's an expectation value of the three volume at a given time is described, apparently, by that of a de Sitter universe. Again, on large scales. And what you also find, so let me draw a little picture, maybe on a new blackboard. So what is this shape variable? What we do, we simulate now geometries in the spirit of, you know, these kind of with a cylinder topology. So in four dimensions, you choose compact slices, which are topological three spheres. You could choose any other topology. It doesn't matter. That's kind of the simplest choice you can make. And of course, you want it. You need it to be finite, so it cannot be, you know, an R3. And choosing an S3 also avoids any discussions of, you know, what are boundary contributions. So therefore, what we are superposing are curved, big rotated Lorentzian simplicial manifolds of that topology and of a, say, of a fixed four volume and of a fixed time extension. So we are just simulating like a chunk of universe that only, you know, lives for a limited amount of proper time. And you can then choose some boundary conditions at the in and the out, the initial and final time. What you can also do is to cyclically identify. And it turns out it does. This doesn't affect really, you might say, oh, that's something very acausal and nasty to do. But it doesn't really affect the local physics as long, you know, as these boundaries are kind of far away. It doesn't really matter what you choose them to be. Now, the shape is now in the superposition is the expectation value of what the three volume is as a function of time. So, you know, you take, you walk with your Monte Carlo simulations, you know, it makes a random walk in your space of configurations, and you pick one, and you look what is V3 of tau. And tau is a proper time, and it might look something like that. Well, it doesn't exactly, but let's say it looks something like this. Then you go to the next statistically independent configuration, you repeat the measurements. And what you then do, you superpose the measurements, and it turns out actually that all the shapes you're getting, well, they, if you make this tall long enough, they develop some kind of stalk where the universe wants to shrink to a minimal size. So you get this kind of stalk. Then the universe exists in the sense of having a finite three volume, and then it goes back to zero. You can identify for each of them kind of some center of volume, let's put it here. And then in order to get this expectation where you superpose them on each other. And what you then get, so this is now a single, say, V3 of tau. But what you get for the ensemble average is a specific shape. As a function of tau. And what this turns out to be, this is called also a volume profile. It turns out with very great accuracy to be the volume profile of a Euclidean de Sitter space. Shall I just remind you what a what's a volume element? So let me first write here. So V3 of tau, just for definiteness, is the universe's spatial volume at proper time tau. So that's all I'm plotting here in these sketches. And if you do cosmology, you and look kind of at the dynamics of the scale factor of the universe, you often use a variable that's called little a, the scale factor. But this is simply proportional. Well, this has dimensions of a length. So if you are working with the scale factor a of tau, then a cubed is exactly proportional to this v, right? But so this is a variable that you that's often used in cosmology. If you just look at Friedman cosmologies, so this is where a of tau is the scale factor of the universe. So it's just the third root of the three volume. Now, what is well, Euclidean de Sitter space. Well, I give you the volume, sorry, this is the line, the infinitesimal line element, and then you know what it is. In order to compare, I go to a parameterization here where explicit, where the time variable is already proper time. So then I can kind of directly compare. And in the continuum, I get a minus, a detour squared plus c squared cosine squared tor divided by c d omega squared index 3. This is the volume element of the unit 3 sphere. So element of the 3 sphere. Well, this variable C is this is proportional to lambda or 1 over lambda. Let me just see. I didn't write it here. So this depends on lambda. So it sets the scale, of course. The bigger this C, the larger the universe. So this is indeed inversely proportional to lambda. And of course, you recognize that if you re-quotate this tor here, you know, if you write it as it, then this becomes a minus t squared, and the cosine squared becomes a cosh squared. And of course, what is a cosh squared for late times? It's just exponential growth. And that's, of course, the characteristic feature of the Sitter space. And as a matter of fact, we believe our own universe at late times is described by a de Sitter space with accelerated expansion. Okay, which is just exactly such given by such an exponential. So we recognize here various properties. Here we are in the Euclidean domain. So this becomes a compact thing. And, well, this here is actually, so my V3 of tor. So how do I compute this now explicitly in my formulation? It's just according to the scheme for the observables I presented to you yesterday. It's a normalized sum of all triangulations, causal triangulations, with this weight factor, where I have kind of, as one says, inserted in the trace this particular variable V3 of tor, e to the minus s regi of t. And simply, I mean, just from the computer measurements, this just comes out as proportional to cosine cubed tor over c. And that's exactly what you'd expect. That is, here this thing is, roughly speaking, your a squared of tor. So an a is like a cosine, and the volume, the 3 volume, therefore, is a cosine cubed. I cannot present you the very impressive plots here on the blackboard, which you just get by comparing kind of the theoretical form of this curve with the actual measurements. And you can go beyond this. You can then also look at quantum fluctuations around this picture. So some variables, delta V3. And you can look at how they behave and compare that to a kind of quantum mechanical mini superspace model calculation, where you also can then establish kind of an effective quantum Hamiltonian for these volume fluctuations. And you can again compare numerical data with these theoretical kind of semi-classical, I mean, kind of quadratic approximation for these quantum fluctuations. And again, you find a very good agreement. Yeah. So it goes beyond just this shape. But of course, the remarkable thing is, yeah, the way this comes out. Yes. So, and of course, you haven't really you really have taken a non-perturbative superposition of things. And they just, you know, I say, conspire in a certain way to produce this result. And it's not that we understand in detail how this happens, because it's also clear that, again, entropy, so the measure, somehow plays a big role in producing this result. So it's highly non-perturbative, but in this way, maybe even more remarkable. So this is a genuine example of emergence, I would say. So a non-perturbative quantum gravity model, and here based on these CDT geometries, this path interval. Is in this way seen to generate its own background or its own quantum geometry. So it's exactly a realization of what I said initially, something we'd like to happen. We just write down a quantum dynamical principle and we solve it, and the solution, well, we just look at what the solution is and what properties it has. So this here, since kind of entropy of microstates is crucially also involved, it is a kind of phenomenon of emergence in the quite literal sense that such a word is also used in condensed matter models, say. Yes?
So you're getting this space naturally.
Yes. In part, yes, in part, not. You see, of course, I could have chosen a more complicated spatial topology, and then it's not so clear what I would have obtained here. That's true. Things like that, we've actually played in lower dimensions. I can tell you more about it if you're interested in. Now, one non-trivial thing that has happened here is, of course, I didn't start out so. What is de Sitter space, Euclidean de Sitter space? It's an S4. It's an S4. So the system tells me it wants to be an S4 on large scales. Because this is not exactly what I started with. Because I started with interval. Actually, I either interval or S1 cross S3. And you would have said, oh, look, you're biasing yourself. You're putting this on a torus of this kind. So, well, it clearly hasn't prevented the dynamical, the observation, what I observe here. You know, I fixed a certain topology. I have to make some sort of choice. But then the system dynamically tells me where it wants to be. And here it wants to be as close to an S4 as I allow it. And actually, when I said, look, here it goes to volume zero, that's not exactly true, because we are actually imposing regularity conditions. It cannot shrink to zero. So the universe cannot go away, but for some regularity conditions just on the geometries, we enforce a little minimal volume here. But nevertheless, it's totally clear that that's where the system wants to be. So you start out from one topology, and nevertheless, dynamics drives you to a different topology. And it's kind of very, very obvious. So that's something very nice, because you could have been worried, of course, that you introduced a bias here, so this, but it just turns out not to be so. Or at least it's clear where the system is going dynamically within the configuration space you allow it to be. Can I say a little bit more about dimensionality? I wanted to make one last point here. Now, let me introduce the variable t for the part of the time interval where the universe is not minimal or not zero. Okay. So it's just the size, its size, its time extension. It exists for a finite time, and the period is kind of I'm comparing to is the period of this cosine, but I'm in half period of the cosine. Let me call this capital T. And what I'm now interested in, you know, we were talking about scaling properties. I'm now interested in seeing what this, how this expectation value is a truly dynamical thing, behaves as a function of the four volume. And what I do is I change the four volume. And like I said yesterday, I systematically am interested how do things depend on the volume, total volume that I'm cutting off. So I enlarge the volume systematically, you know, N4, I choose this to be whatever. 50,000, 100,000, 150,000, you know, up to whatever, 350,000. And what I find here is that within measuring accuracy, this scales like the fourth root of that four volume. And why is, we say, oh, well, clearly it has to be like this. Well, I yesterday explained to you that, well, it's not automatic, so it's something you have to show. This is, of course, the expected canonical scaling. When I look at a linear dimension of a four-dimensional space, well, that's what is my expectation of how it scales. And similarly, I can also look at exactly the three volume, how this scales as a function of the four volume, so the number of four-dimensional simplices, and it scales like N4 to the 3/4 with very good accuracy. So here I would deduce that macroscopically this is a canonical scaling. Canonical just means as I would expect if it were really a four-dimensional space. So this is called canonical scaling. And of course, deviations from canonical scaling indicate possible quantum behavior. And if I had more time, which I do not have, I could. So this was point one. So this all concerns, in a way, large-scale behavior and some indication that you can match it to certain properties of a classical solution to the Einstein equations. So that's very nice. And it's, of course, it's a natural solution with a positive cosmological constant you have is exactly the Zitter space in the absence of matter. So point number two, I just write this down. Don't go much further than this. So this is a continuation of the concrete evidence for point number two, that you get highly non-classical behavior, nevertheless, on short scales. Short scales. So apparently, on very short scales, I mean Planckian scales, close to the Planck scales, one gets an effective dimensionality. And there are various, again, one is then a regime where also the Hausdorff dimension is not four. One looks at something that's called the spectral dimension. It's just an effective dimension one extracts by studying random walks. And this appears to be two within measuring accuracy on short distance scales, whereas, of course, four would be the expected classical value. And one can also find, if one looks at the geometries on short scale, find certain fractal properties. And I should say, since we came up with this, is just some measured thing. So you get basically a curve spectral dimension as a function of length scale that looks something like this. It asymptotes to four, and here is somewhere, you know, around two. So this is just a length scale probed on your quantum manifold. So you find a notion of dimension which you can measure, and this is very similar in spirit to what we did for the Hausdorff dimension by invoking a random walks that explore your space. And from those, you extract another dimensionality, the spectral dimension. And it turns out to have a scale-dependent behavior with a large scale limit that's compatible with the expected classical value but on short scale, something that signifies that clearly this has nothing to do with the differential manifold. Certainly not even with a two-dimensional differential manifold, because it, you know, it changes here smoothly through dimensionalities. And since we've came up with this, that has been picked up by many other people, and everyone is now computing spectral dimensions in their own favorite version of gravity, quantum gravity, and often comes up with similar, qualitatively similar results. So there's clearly something to be understood here. Okay, now, this just finishes not just today's lecture, but the entire course. So this last piece, you should have, you know, you should take as just an outlook on current research and how in a concrete model, how far you can currently push things. And of course, it's very much work in progress. And who knows, maybe one of you will eventually contribute to that progress. But we are not quite there yet. So, you know, for the time being, I hope you've enjoyed the course. And it was a pleasure being here. And good luck with the rest of Psi and what comes after.
On behalf of all people at Psi, let me present to Renata the shirt.
Thank you very much
for the wonderful course, and invite her to teach this course next year.
Oh, from now on, you know, until until eternity, or until the cosinus reaches to zero again.
Until then, yeah. From our side, just an infinitesimal gift of gratitude. Thank you.
That is very good of you. Thank you so much.